You know, I was, you know, before the Lord these, you know, this last week really, and really felt like the Lord just gave me a, you know, just a simple message, you know, just a simple word. Now, you know, I don't know if you're like me, I was wanting something like deeper. He's like, Phil, some things just are, you know, even when you think of God, it just is, you know. And then he reminded me of certain things throughout the week, like a sunset. When you picture a sunset, just is. As simple as it is, yet is the grandeur and the magnificence of a sunset. It just is. I don't really have to say much. I just got to say sunset or sunrise or waves crashing on the shore or a mother holding a newborn infant and looking into the eyes like it's the only thing that matters in life. Some things just are in their most simplest and purest form. And I believe he gave me a few things, but he said, Phil, it just is. So the title this morning, if you saw it, it's Inherit the Earth. Now, there have been lots of folks over the course of history that have tried to inherit the earth, right? Alexander the Great, he was going to conquer the world. The entire world was going to be his. Had a tremendous army. Had tremendous wealth, horses. Guess what, church? He failed. He didn't conquer it. Napoleon, he was going to conquer the world. He didn't. Hitler, he wanted the world. He failed also. Now, you can go to Scripture as well. I mean, there's lots of folks in the Bible. Nebuchadnezzar, you know, I think of Nebuchadnezzar. You know, he was gonna have it all, right? He had a great army, and he thought he was there. He thought he had it. He's like, oh, man, I am on the precipice of conquering the entire world. And what happened? God took it right from underneath him. Had nothing. And Daniel says that. He raises up kings, and he also takes down kings. So none of them, in all of their wisdom, they all had scholars and all that, all their money, all their armies, everything. They couldn't do it. And yet here, we're told that the meek actually inherit the earth. Now, church, I don't know about you, but I gave this some thought, and I'm like, I don't even own my house. How do I get the earth? I don't even own my car, right? I got to make payments on that. Like, really, the only thing I own when I really try and reconcile the list, if you have a list, is like the clothes on my back. I did pay cash for those, and they're mine. So how am I getting the earth? How do I get the earth? And of course, you know, God is a greater message here, and it's, you know, as you're familiar with, you know, probably this passage in Scripture, it's in Matthew 5. I think my brother also says it's the attitudes you should be in, the Beatitudes, which is very true. But you know, Jesus, when he ascended to the mount, he basically, you know, gives probably the most powerful message, you know, ever preached, and, you know, has just tremendous lessons in here. And of course, this is, you know, the third beatitude: blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. But, you know, when he started this, when he went up there and the multitude followed him, he said he began to teach. And so this is a teaching moment when you actually inherit the earth. And I believe, you know, the way we inherit the earth really is, does the earth have you, or do you have the earth? You see, because he said heaven is his throne and the earth is his footstool. So how do we inherit the earth? Well, if it's his footstool, it ought to be our footstool. What's his is mine, and what's mine is his. Can I get an amen? At least that's what Song of Solomon says, so I'm going to believe that to be true. But really, that is it, church. Does the earth have you, or do you have the earth? And again, we're talking spiritually. Because the first two Beatitudes, it starts out with you got to be poor in spirit, but you do get the kingdom of heaven. Heaven does become before earth, amen? How do you inherit heaven? You've got to be poor in spirit. Well, how do I know if my spirit is poor, Pastor? Simple. Do you believe you came in here this morning with nothing and you need something? Yes. You're poor in spirit. Congratulations. We're all poor in spirit. I came in here this morning because I needed something. It starts there. But I know when I do that, when you do that, you do get the kingdom of heaven. It may be in its simplest and purest form, but it's still heaven nonetheless, amen? The second one, he says then, is blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. So after I'm poor, I'm supposed to mourn. How's the Christian life going so far, church? Well, I got nothing and now I'm crying. Isn't that how it works? What are we mourning over? And you got to see this through the eyes of Christ. It's just like when Jesus, he said, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. He said, I called you to come. You know, like the mother that calls her chicks. But he just wants to be like the mother I saw this week, just holding this infant baby like it's the only thing in the world that matters. And those of you that have children, you've done that, where it's the only thing in life that matters. Nothing. It's amazing. Everything gets blocked out in this moment. And I believe that's the same message with Jesus Christ. And why was he crying? He's like, man, I just want a relationship. I just want to hold you like this. He said, but you won't even come. You won't even come. And that's, I believe, what the mourning is. You will be comforted because he also says that, right? He says, come to me, all who you labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. It's an open invite, church. He says, come. He also said that he will in no wise cast you away. Because sometimes I say, man, I can't come. He's going to know X, Y, and Z, and he's going to go, stop right there. But it's just not true, church. I don't believe it. I don't see it. I don't think it. But he says to come. He wants to comfort you. He wants to give you rest. But you do have to come. And then he said what? That you're supposed to learn from me in that same verse. He says, put on my yoke that you learn from me. It's easy. With Christ, everything is easy. Without him, it's a train wreck. But with him, everything is possible. So I believe it's the purpose is not for the earth to have us. And it's just, he also says that's, what is the sin? He talks about all the sins. He also says it's buried in the verse when he's talking about lust and pride and anger and hate and the cares of life. The cares of life are buried in that verse. It's buried in there for a reason. What are your cares in life this morning? Does the earth have you or do you have the earth? Is it a job? Is it a relationship? Is it a sickness? I mean, we can go down the earthly list. Does it have you or do you have it? You will be happy. Blessed are they. It means you will be happy. That's what it means. But I believe it's so that so how do we inherit the earth? I believe, really, it's fairly simple, church, through the words of Christ. I do believe it's fairly simple, and I believe that's just the message for us. But I know in that, in its simplest and purest form, I'll find rest. I'll find my maker, my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'll have a relationship with him. I know I'm yoked with him. And the truth is that, like, that's why he says, you can never leave me nor forsake me. But I know then it's through this meekness. And it's cool when you look up the word meek, because I don't know how you want to define meekness, right? There's a lot of different, you know, verses and even definitions of meekness and humility. And, you know, one is, you know, power under control. But when you look at this Greek word here, it's actually talking about, you know, a thoroughbred or a stallion that has all the power in the world, but it'll only do and move when it's commanded to do and move. That's the Greek definition of meekness. And I believe that through that, there is tremendous power. So John, chapter 6, verse 9. Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fishes. But how far will they go among so many? Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. He did the same with the fish. And of course, this is the account where he fed, I think in this instance here, it was either the 5,000 or the 2,000. I don't remember the number, because then he has the other instance. There's 2 instances where he fed the many. But he said, How is it gonna take care of so many when I have these small loaves and these small fishes? But he said, according to the word of God here, that everybody got as much as they wanted, both of the bread and the fish. See, this is where we have the earth. The earth doesn't have us. And this is, I believe, just the picture that Jesus Christ shows us. I see the bread here is, you know, the bread, the word of God, it's spirit, right? But I see the fish is also, you know, it's our humanity. We are flesh and blood. Matter of fact, Bill and I were just talking before service. When he went to the disciples after the cross, and they said, oh, he's a ghost. Like, what are you talking about? Feel me. I'm flesh and bone here. I'm a body. I'm living. I'm breathing. So it's our divinity, and it's our humanity. The bread of life, it's our divinity. It is the spirit of life that's inside of us. It's the spirit of God. But I also see the fish, it's our humanity. But they're small, church. The bread's small, and the fish is small. You see, you got to be small. You got to be humble. You can't be big. You got to be small. But in our smallness, in our littleness, then you can and you will feed many. You can touch many. And they can have as much as they want, as long as you're willing to be small. Amen? Titus says this, to speak evil of no man, to be no brawlers, but gentle, showing meekness unto all men. And I believe this is the picture of Jesus Christ. Like, he didn't survey the crowd and see who deserves the fish and who deserves the bread. He said, they all get the bread. They all get the fish. How many? As many as show up. Whoever shows up should get bread. Whoever shows up should get a fish. They should get my spirit man, but they should also get my natural man. It does show up in the form of humility. It does, you know, he does need a body, church. Amen? There's several songs that say, we're the hands and feet of Christ. It's got to show up in the form of humanity. How? Well, to be meek unto all men. To never speak evil of no man. Yeah, but what if they're not telling the truth? Well, then go right ahead and rip their head off. Oh, no. Nope. It says no man. Never speak evil of no person. Period. Don't argue. Don't fight. Be gentle. Be meek. When I do that, guess what? I inherit the earth. When I fight with you, or choose to fight with you, or if I'm not gentle, now guess what? The earth has me. Because I care about the earthly things above the heavenly things. I'm not poor in spirit. And so my priorities, sometimes my priorities get out of whack, church. Or I just lose sight, or I forget. And so I become the brawler. But then I don't inherit anything. What I inherit? I usually inherit heartache, trouble. Or maybe it's just like you're alone, you're like, oh, Lord, why'd I do that, man? He's like, it's okay, it's just a simple lesson for you to learn. Move on from here. Oh, okay, thank you, Lord. Like the first thing that's got to happen, you know, we talked about vision a couple of weeks ago. There's got to be an awareness. You got to see it. But then hopefully once you see it, I pray the next words are like my words. Lord, help me change that. Help me to be meek to all men no matter what the circumstances are. Help me to be meek and never speak poorly. Help me to be gentle, even in the absence of truth, even in the absence of goodness, even in the absence of whatever. Because I do know that the kingdom of heaven, that's my throne, that's where I reside, that's my power, that's my strength. And really, that is the real strength, amen? Humility gives us the strength to control ourselves, not others. Newsflash, we control nothing but ourselves. That's it. But that's the power, church. That is the power. Remember when, you know, Jesus was before Pilate, he said, don't you realize I have the power to take your life? He said, you have no power, only that which is given to you by the Father. He said, but I have the power, Jesus Christ says, I have the power to lay it down and take it up. So sometimes you got to lay it down. Now, it doesn't mean, hey, I'm going to be humble. You're not nice. Now I'm picking up my humble and walking away. No. You have the power to lay it down, meaning I'm not going to argue and fight over this. I'm going to lay it down. Then I have the power to take it up. What did he take up? He took up the cross, church. I can carry the burden. Sometimes you do have to carry a burden. But you have to do it in humility. That's what he was sharing. That's essentially what he was showing us. So yes, humility, you'll lay it down. But you sometimes have to take up the burden. Because sometimes the burden exists. Sometimes it's hard to say, I just can't get rid of this burden. I can't get rid of this issue. Perhaps not right now, you can't. But you do have the power to carry it. You see, that's why you got to be yoked to Jesus Christ. Because I believe, if I'm yoked to him, what can I carry? Like if he literally showed up in the flesh and somehow cuffed himself to you, would you worry about much that you go through the cross of that day? Not if Jesus Christ is, you know. And it's like, I'm cuffing him because he ain't going nowhere either. So we control ourselves. That's the power. I'm able to control myself. I'm able to control my earth. I can't control the earth around me, but I control my earth. And then allow God to change me. And then through that, I believe he will change the world. But it's not in controlling others. The only way to do that is you got to be small. Nobody likes being small, church. I get that. But I think we're learning more and more the power of small. The power of small. The power of simple. The power of pure. I mean, he said to be still and know that I am God. Amen? Anybody ever read that psalm before? Because my Bible says he's omnipotent. No matter what's going on crazy in the earth, in this world, I can still be still and know that there is God and he has complete autonomy and control over everything. That's meekness, church. And I got to be small to see that, to believe that. Amen? This is in Isaiah. And he shall judge among the nations, and he shall rebuke many people. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up their sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. This is a beautiful passage in Isaiah. You know, I thought about going through the whole thing, but I was like, nah, there's too many simple points I want to bring out, and I don't want to get sidetracked. But I believe this, church. I do believe at some point we've got to change the way we live. And I believe it starts here. I believe this is how we start to become small, where I don't learn war anymore. Where the sword I used to have, I change it, and it becomes now a plowshare. You know, this spear that I have, because I didn't want to get that close to you, so I just figured I'd hurl it from across the room, Ken. You know what I'm saying? I got to change that so that I can actually now get at the wheat, and I turn it into a pruning hook so that I know how to cultivate, and I know how to get after that. And I love this passage here because it does say there's change coming. Because it's like sometimes you say, I'm humble. Humble doesn't usually have a voice, church. Just 411 on that, okay? You know, when people say, oh, I'm humble, you blew it. You're not. I believe humility is silent. Because my Bible says that he was the mute lamb, that he spoke no words even though he was going to the shearer to be sheared. And someone may take my clothing, they may shear me, they may strip me down naked, but I'll be silent just the same. Doesn't mean that I don't do anything. Because sometimes you say, who cares? No, that's not the position. The position is I've got to take these tools, I've got to turn them into something. I still got to do something. Humility has to do something. It doesn't sit back and do nothing. That's not humility. Humility is power under control. It is the awareness of God in my life, but I then take these tools and I got something I got to do. He's going to use me. But he can't use you if you're not coming from a position of humility. But if I got to put on my name badge, Mr. Humility, shut it down, church. You're fired. It doesn't work. That's not how humility works. I do believe it works through silence, through no words spoken. Again, at least based on the absolute perfection of humility, Jesus Christ. Because he never once defended his position. Through all the craziness and all the insanity of that moment, if you were to just take it and put it in today's time, and the way that whole thing went down, and the way they created the lies, and they went after him, and judged him, and persecuted him, and all he was silent through it all. He was the absolute perfect picture of humility. There was nothing but power and strength in that. There wasn't weakness in it. It was impossible. That's impossible for him to be weak. Impossible. Because he turned his sword and he turned his spear into an instrument used to do something far greater than war. He answered and he said unto them, he that soweth the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, church. What do you know? There's a field out there. And the good seed are the children of the kingdom, but the tares are the children of the wicked one. What is the good seed? It's the children of the kingdom. It's the blessed are the poor in spirit. They got something to give. I'm supposed to take my sword, my instruments here that I use to fight with. I don't learn word no more. And now instead I'm sowing something here. I'm sowing Christ. I'm sowing Christ. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He saith not unto seeds, as of many, but as of one, and to thy seed, which is Christ. There's only one seed, church. Only one. And it's the only one, thank God, that matters. It is Christ. Christ and Christ alone. But I do need a plowshare. And there's often many passages in the Bible that talk about farming. And, you know, I think Paul also said that God is the husbandry. He's basically a farmer. He is plowed a seed. It is the seed of Christ. And who's the good seed? It's just the children of the kingdom. It's those that are humble, that understand what their power is. They no longer learn to make war anymore. Humility will eventually quit looking for a fight and change its weapons into instruments for sowing. You see, we gotta quit looking for the fight, church. Well, sometimes, hey, he brought the fight to me. They generally do. You still gotta quit fighting. Again, it doesn't mean I don't do anything. I love this picture this morning. I love this picture for the Christian life. It's not that you don't do anything. It doesn't mean you get to walk away. Well, fine, I'm out of here. That's not humility, church. My Bible says we're supposed to take those spears and do something with them. He's got something for you to do. Don't avoid the situation, because sometimes they say it's just avoidance. Now, sometimes the situations can be hostile. Yeah, you probably need to avoid them, you know, let things cool down or whatever. You know, you got to err on the side of sound judgment, right? Amen? We all know what sound judgment looks like. But it doesn't mean that I walk away from situations or I walk away from people. No, because I'm supposed to be the good seed. But I'm supposed to change. There is going to be change. Where you just quit fighting over stuff. You quit arguing over stuff. Maybe the whole point of that situation in your life showing up was for God to show you how to just lay it down. Just lay it down. Whatever it is, you're not going to fight. I'm just going to lay it down. Now you can take your hammer and you can just start banging on that sword a little, because now you're turning into a plowshare. You ain't going to make this thing a plowshare overnight, church. It's going to take a few bangs. Can I get an amen? It might take a lifetime of bangs. I don't know. I'm still banging mine out. I'm going to tell you right now. It's not done. It's nice. It's coming along. You know my handiwork, so it's not as pretty as Mike's, but church, I'm working on it. I'm going to let him paint my handle, though. Or you may have to pick up the burden, carry the burden. Don't walk away from it. Carry it. Figure out how to carry it. Ask God, Lord, help me figure out how to carry this thing. Because I'm not looking for war. I don't learn that way of life no more. He said to learn from me. I got to quit trying to figure it out myself and learning stuff myself. How do I do that? Well, I got to quit fighting, man. Quit fighting with the neighbor, the person at work, your spouse, your family, whoever it is in life, church. I'm not sure your position, but it's likely you got one or two answers generally in those situations. Either lay it down or carry it. Lay it down or carry it. If you can lay it down and move on. If it can't because the issue is something, because it just can't be laid down, then carry it. Then carry it. But then I'll know that you've changed your weapons of war into instruments of sowing Christ. Amen? Amen? Revelations. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name. See, and that's the beauty, the simple beauty, power of humility. It just takes a little strength, church. Just a little humility can go a whole long way. Amen? But I got to keep his word. It's not like I can, because that's how we get disconnected sometimes. That's why this really does help us to properly define, I believe, faith, life, God, and he will do that through the course of life. It's not like, you know, my lifestyle should contradict his word. Then is the word wrong or am I wrong? Obviously, I'm wrong. So I know then that my lifestyle should line up with his word. The witness of two or more, my life is a witness, his word is a witness. Now we have two. And I pray there's a third and a fourth and a fifth, and it goes on from there. But what? I keep the word. I keep the words of Jesus Christ. But it only takes a little bit of strength. And I love it. What happens? You open doors all over the place. Doors will be open. When do the doors get shut? The minute my strength becomes big and it ain't little and I ain't small no more. Then it's probably not going to be very effective. And nobody can shut that door on you. When you choose to be humble, can anybody stop it? No, it's impossible. That's what he's saying here. It's impossible. But you'll have all the strength in the world. You'll have all the strength you need. You'll open doors everywhere. That's how you get the victory. How did Jesus Christ get the victory? Through humility. Through humility, he got the victory. Because my Bible says he had the victory. Amen? My Bible says he conquered sin and death. Amen? Well, how did he do that? He actually was pretty quiet. He actually only used a little bit of humility. And he got it all done. He got it all done. He saved the entire world. And he didn't even tell anybody about it. He just did it. Wow. Wow. I know that you're Abraham's seed, but you seek to kill me because my word has no place in you. And this is Jesus Christ talking to the scribes and the Pharisees when he was telling them that, you know, the only way through to be free is through basically the Spirit of God. Spirit of Christ, whom he has made free, is free indeed. Free to what? Free to live a life unto God and not have the earth impact my life. And they say, whoa, we're from Abraham's seed. Jesus Christ says, you're right. You are. He didn't argue with them. You are Abraham's seed. Everybody's Abraham's seed, church. There's only one seed. It is Christ. Amen. We just said that. But however, this is why you got to keep the word. He says, my word has no place in your life. This means nothing to you. You can quote it, which they could. They can quote, most of those guys can quote books of the Bible. Books. I can't do that, church. I can't. Those guys could literally quote some of the Mosaic books, which to me is just so daunting. Thank God. I don't know. Today's grace is just different. We don't have to. Amen. Not that I don't want it. I do. I wish I did and could do that. He says, it has no place in you. You want to kill me. You're Abraham's seed. You have no power. You certainly have no humility. And that's what happens when God's word has no place in our life. When it has no place in your life, we will fight. We will learn to make war and we will look to kill. We just do. But when it has place in my life, when I say this is the only thing in life that matters to me, and when I start my day with it and end my day with it, it will become you. The word became flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus Christ became in flesh this word. What? He does it and then we're out? It should become us. That's why we go here and it becomes us. And I believe he reveals the word that's in us in its simplest and purest form. Yeah, you're Abraham's seed. That's great. But does the word have any place in your life? Does it have preeminence in your life? Do we look to heaven or do we look to earth? Blessed is the one who perseveres under trial, because having stood the test, that person will receive a crown of life that the Lord has promised to those that love him. You do have to persevere, church. You do have to withstand the test. Jesus Christ withstood the test. He didn't buckle. When he was in front of Pilate, he didn't buckle. He withstood the test. He was humble to the point of obedience to death. You can't buckle, church. And I thought of that passage in Revelations. Be faithful unto death, for I've given you. Even if it's to death, church, you do get the crown of life. It is the crown of life. And again, what's the crown of life? It's the awareness of God in my life. It's the awareness that there's something so much greater here than this earthly, you know, these earthly situations and dilemmas and, you know, whatever the cares of life happen to be for us this day. There's something so much greater than all of that. But it's unlocked all of it through humility. It's the only way it'll become your footstool, church. Either you have it or it has you. The more I have it, the happier life is, amen? Humility will keep God's word and never give up. I mean, I know you're going to face some trials, and I know it may take a while. Listen, Jesus, it didn't happen in an instant. That went on for a while. You do have to persevere. And then through it all, you don't give up. Because again, humility isn't giving up, church. It's actually holding on a little tighter. Amen? Humility doesn't give up. No, that's silly. Jesus Christ never gave up. Just because he laid down his life, come on. It doesn't give up. So we don't give up on God's word. And then more importantly, I pray we don't give up on each other. No matter what you're laying down, no matter what you're carrying, don't give up. Don't give up. As though God doesn't see it, because sometimes we say, man, he just doesn't see it. He just don't know. That's silly, church. It's just silly. It's silly thinking. I think that way, though, so I get it. But then he comes along and he does whisper, and I'm like, oh, he's there. And I remember, you know, who I am. And I remember, you know, what rules and reigns in my life. It's heaven. It's faith. It's God. I mean, pick whatever is a comfort spot for you and hold it. But it'll include God, amen? Ecclesiastes, I love this passage in Ecclesiastes. There was a little city and a few men within it, and there came a great king against it, and he besieged it and built great bulwarks against it. Now there was found in it a poor wise man, and he was, by his wisdom, delivered the city. Yet no man remembered that same poor man. Who is this quiet man saving this little city? And who is this king wreaking havoc against the city? But yet somehow, this guy, which nobody seems to remember, does anybody remember him? I don't remember him. Do you remember him? That same man delivered the city. Wow. And of course, again, you got to look at this spiritually speaking. It is, of course, talking about the humility of Christ that dwells inside of us. You know the king that's messing up my city and banging and building walls and, yeah, me. It's a good old knucklehead me. I'm going to fight and I'm going to stand my ground and I'm going to. Too many I'm gunners, church. I got to tell you. Me, too many I'm gunners. How about we shut that down for a day or so? And what? Well, how about we let this poor, obscure nobody save the city? He doesn't even have a name. Guy saves the city. He doesn't even have a name. Seems odd to me. But he does say he's wise. You mean there's wisdom in humility? You mean there's actual godly wisdom in living a life like that? And I actually get to save the city? Seems pretty powerful to me, church. Listen, until you save your city, you ain't gonna save no world. I mean, you're just not. I'm not. I mean, he did say to preach the gospel, amen? I'm the only one that read that passage? Or didn't he say go out into the world and, you know, the far-reaching places? And if you don't save your city, you ain't saving nothing. How are you going to do that? Through humility. With a quiet spirit. Doesn't Peter say that? Doesn't he say a meek and quiet spirit? It's a great price in the sight of God. What does God consider, the most unbelievable price tag? Because he's having everything, right? Like, what does he consider, like, you know, you ever go looking, shopping, and like, whoo, that's a lot of money. Like, you know, maybe if you're shopping for a car or something, whoo, how much? That's a great price. What is God, he says, the meek and quiet person. He considers that a great price. Now, it is a price, yet there's a cost associated to a church. It's not free. You know what the cost is? Yeah, you got to lay it down. Sometimes you got to carry it. There's a price. There is a price. There is a price. I know we like free. Salvation's free. Grace is free. Faith is free. He's placed it inside you. You don't have to do anything for it. He's given it to you. When will it become a great price? When I actually put it into action. When he actually sees me live it out. Great price. Great price. When I'm humble and I'm quiet and I save the city, great price. Great price. Now, if I gotta, you know, blow my trumpet and tell you about it, nah, that's a discount right there, man. That ain't a great price, man. That's okay. Listen, it doesn't start right away. I believe it takes, because every now and then I did something good. All right, you're getting there, Phil. I appreciate you doing good, but can you put the trumpet away? What do you say? Don't let the right hand know what the left hand's doing? So maybe I'm not supposed to tell you about it? But I did good. Shouldn't someone know I did good? Shouldn't somebody know that I handed somebody some money and fed this one? And shouldn't somebody know? Not the wise man. The wise man says, you don't even know I showed up. You don't even know I did it. The gospel, isn't it funny? Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. And may ever, we could ever grab that one. Not looking to your own interest, but each of you, the interest of others. I mean, does it get any simpler in what he's saying there? Do nothing out of selfish ambition. You know what I do? I do everything out of selfish ambition. And then I try and peel it away and peel it away and peel it away and say, Lord, help me, peel it away, peel it away, peel it away. Why are we that way? I don't even understand it. The mysteries of God. But it's okay. I do know that God is strengthening us and making us more aware. And yes, in the 30 years. And yes, in the year of maturity. Man, stop peeling it away, Lord. Help me peel that away, Lord. Help me get rid of that, Lord. And you know the only one that's going to know the progress being made? You and God, usually. Now, it'll manifest itself, and I believe it'll be seen, but it's not talked about. Again, it's not, you're not speaking about these things. It's just the purest and simplest of form, just like the sunset, just like the sunrise. That's how I see humility. It just shows up, and then it's like, woo,